As you embark on your way to the cross here tonight, remember, you do not walk these 14 steps alone. I walk with you, for my spirit lives in you. Therefore, the path I walked 2,000 years ago and your path now are one. Note this difference. Though my life was incomplete until I crowned it by my death, your way will only be complete when you have crowned it by your life.
He was born the son of a virgin, a controversy even at birth. He was carried away to a distant country for fear of his life.
When he was 12 years old, he challenged the religious leaders of his day.
He brought healing where disease had brought only devastation. Thousands marveled at his endless mercy.
He forgave when others condemned.
Outcasts found a home in his presence.
He gave life to those whom death had already claimed.
So great was his display of power that he confounded the understanding of even the noblest of minds.
He preached a new message.
He gathered the poor, the sick, the persecuted, and called them profoundly blessed.
He measured greatness by making a child the example.
No chains of race or status could bind him.
But the rulers of this world set their powers against him.
Many who cried out, "Hosanna," were swept away by rage fueled by envy and fear.
"Crucify him," rang out, deafening his song of hope.
He was betrayed by those who could not stand and judged by those who could not see.
He died a criminal's death, but his last words were in defense of his executioners.
Those who pierced his side later took his side.
For 3 days, death struggled to claim this tender outcast, this fierce rebel, but lost its grip to the resurrected power of his divine manhood.
His has been history. For 2,000 years, mankind has sought to tell it.
All the poets who ever penned a verse,
all the musicians who ever composed a melody,
and all the artists who ever formed an image,
have only captured glimpses of that decisive moment
when God showed the world his one true masterpiece.
A young man appeared from out of the desert and traveled through the Jordan district, issuing a prophetic call. Startling in his passion and conviction, he proclaimed,
"Repent! For the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. Prepare the way of the Lord."
Proclaiming,
"I baptize you in the water for repentance, but the one who follows me ranks above me because he existed before me. I am not fit to untie his sandals. He will baptize you in the Holy Spirit and fire."
It was at this time that Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee. He joined the crowd to hear John preach and presented himself for baptism in the river. It was revealed to John that this was Jesus, the Messiah, and he said,
"It is I who should be baptized by you, and yet you come to me?"
"Let it be so. It is only right to do what we are called to do."
John bowed to baptize Jesus. And as Jesus came out of the water, the Holy Spirit appeared in the form of a dove, and there came a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased."
John turned to the people gathered at the riverbank and said,
"This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. "This is the one of whom I spoke when I said one follows me, who ranks above me. I did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be known to you."
Jesus called 12 men to follow him, learn from him, and teach others what they had learned. They accompanied him as he traveled from village to village, teaching the young and the old, healing the sick, restoring life, and forgiving sins.
Come, stop your crying. It'll be all right. Just take my hand, hold it tight. I will protect you from all around you. I will be here, don't you cry. For one so small, you seem so strong. My arms will hold you, keep you safe and warm. This bond between us can't be broken. I will be here, don't you cry. 'Cause you'll be in my heart. Yes, you'll be in my heart. From this day on, now and forevermore. You'll be in my heart. No matter say, you'll be here in my heart, always.
One of the people who responded to Jesus' call was Mary Magdalene. After he cleansed her of 7 demons, she wondered how to thank him, how to love and serve her Lord.
Thank you. You raise me up to more than I can be.
While many responded to Jesus' call, others were plotting against him. The chief priests and Pharisees were angered and threatened by his popularity and discussed what should be done about him.
What are we to do about this man performing these signs? If we allow this to continue, all of our people will believe in him.
If we leave him alone, the entire nation will follow him, and then the Roman army will kill us and take over the Jewish government.
You have no understanding whatsoever. Can you not see that it is better to have one man die than to have an entire nation destroyed?
From that time on, the Jewish leaders conspired to have Jesus arrested. Meanwhile, one of his apostles, Judas Iscariot, began to doubt Jesus. Judas went to the chief priests and asked,
"How much will you pay me to deliver Jesus of Nazareth into your hands?"
"We will pay you 30 pieces of silver."
From that moment on, Judas watched for an opportunity to betray Jesus.
Jesus continued to teach his friends and assure them that he would always be with them. One day, he brought them to a deeper understanding of himself and his Heavenly Father by teaching them how to pray the perfect prayer.
Say this when you pray, "Father, may your name be held holy. May your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive our sins as we forgive others. And do not put us to the test."
With the feast of Passover fast approaching, Jesus traveled to Jerusalem with his 12 apostles. The people, having witnessed many of Jesus' wondrous deeds, lined the roadway, shouting and singing his praise.
Jesus made plans to share the Passover meal with his apostles and sent Peter, James, and John ahead, saying,
"Go into Jerusalem. As soon as you enter the city, you will see a man carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house he enters and say to the man who lives there, 'Our teacher says for you to show us the guest room where he can eat the Passover meal with his disciples. He'll take you upstairs to a large room. That is the place. Go and prepare the meal there.'"
The three men went off and found everything just as Jesus had said, and they prepared the Passover meal. At the proper time, Jesus and the rest of the 12 arrived at the upper room. And as the meal began, Jesus said,
I look forward to sharing this Passover meal with you, my friends, before my time has come. For I tell you, I won't eat bread or drink the fruit of the vine until I do so in my Father's kingdom.
And Jesus took a bowl of water and began to wash the dirt from his friends' feet. As he did so, he revealed the depth of his love for them and humbled himself to their service, asking them to be of service to others.
When Jesus was finished, he prepared to offer himself for the nourishment of the world. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread, blessed it, and gave it to his friends, saying,
This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
A grateful heart, give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given.
Then he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks for it, said,
This is the cup of my blood, the new covenant, that'll be shed for all. Do this in remembrance of me.
A grateful heart, give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given. Jesus Christ, His Son.
As they were finishing their meal, Jesus said to his disciples,
I tell you now that one of you will betray me.
A great sadness swept over them, and they asked,
Could it be me?
Is it me?
Is the one who shared my bowl, for I must die as prophesied. Woe be to the man by whom I am betrayed. It would be far better for him if he had never been born.
Is it I, Rabbi?
It is you who have said it. What you're about to do, do quickly.
None of the disciples knew what Jesus meant or why Judas left quickly. After Judas was gone, Jesus said to the others,
Tonight, you will all desert me.
Master, even if everyone else deserts you, I never will.
Peter, I tell you that before the rooster crows this very night, you'll deny me three times.
Lord, I'd rather die first. Even if I have to die with you, I would never deny you.
With supper ended, Jesus wanted to be with his Father in prayer. He invited the apostles to join him to watch and pray, and they made their way to the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus asked the apostles to wait, while he went on ahead with Peter, James, and John to pray. He began to be filled with the deepest distress, and he said to them,
My soul is crushed by sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and watch with me.
Jesus went on alone and prayed.
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Jesus continued in anguished prayer, and the disciples, their heavy eyes with watching, fell asleep.
Father, if it is possible, let this cup of horror pass from me, but let your will be done, not mine. Father, what have I done that it should come to this?
He then returned to the three disciples and fell them asleep.
Peter, couldn't you stay awake with me even more? Watch with me and pray, lest the tempter overcome you, for the spirit is willing, the body is weak.
And he went away again and prayed.
Father, if this cup cannot pass until I drink it all, let your will be done.
He made his way back to Peter and the others and found them asleep again.
Sleep on now and take your rest. But no, the time has come.
As he said this, Roman soldiers led by Judas Iscariot approached.
Hail, Rabbi!
My friend, do what you have come to do.
Judas walked over to Jesus and kissed him on the cheek. With that, the soldiers seized Jesus and brought him to the high priest's residence. Peter, James, and John followed at a distance, while all the other apostles fled.
A small group gathered around a fire in the high priest's courtyard, and Peter joined them there. A servant woman noticed him in the firelight and began to stare at him. Finally, she spoke.
This man was of Jesus, the Nazarene.
Woman, I did not know what you were talking about.
After a while, someone else looked at him and asked,
Aren't you one of them?
No, I tell you, I'm not.
Later on, another person around the fire said to Peter,
You are one of them, for I can tell by your accent that you are from Galilee.
I told you, I do not know the man.
As Peter said these words, a rooster crowed. He recalled what Jesus had said and ran out of the courtyard, crying bitterly. Realizing that they were getting nowhere in their questioning of Jesus, the chief priest decided to send him to Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor.
Pilate listened to the accusations with an indifferent attitude, as though their religious affairs were too trivial to concern him. Looking for a way to bring the entire matter to a close, Pilate questioned Jesus himself.
Are you the king of the Jews?
It is you who said I am.
And Jesus said no more. It was the governor's custom to release one Jewish prisoner each year during the Passover celebration, any one of the people's choosing. The chief priests and Jewish officials persuaded the crowds to demand the release of a convicted killer named Barabbas and Jesus' death.
Then what shall I do with this Jesus, with your Messiah?
Crucify him!
Why? What wrong has he committed?
In an effort to appease the crowd, Pilate sent Jesus away to be scourged. The soldiers wove a crown of thorns and placed it on his head, and they draped a robe of royal red upon his shoulders. Repeatedly, they mocked him, saying,
All hail, King of the Jews!
When the soldiers brought Jesus out, wearing the crown of thorns and red robe, Pilate called out to the crowd,
Behold the man! I find him not guilty!
The crowd was stirring with anger, and a riot was about to develop. So Pilate washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of the blood of this man. Take him and crucify him yourselves.
And with that, Pilate handed Jesus over to be crucified.
Seeing that Jesus had been condemned to die, Judas began to deeply regret his actions. He brought the 30 pieces of silver back to the chief priest.
I was wrong to betray an innocent man.
What is that to us? That is your affair.
Judas flung the coins at him and ran off. After they raised Jesus on the cross, the entire earth was covered in darkness.
Towards mid-afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
My God,
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Seeing his mother there with John, the apostle whom he loved, he said,
Woman, here is your son. Son, here is your mother.
Knowing that his work was now finished, and in order to bring the scripture to fulfillment, he said,
I am thirsty.
There was a jar there, full of common wine. A soldier stuck a sponge, soaked in wine, on his spear, and raised it to Jesus' lips. Then Jesus called out,
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
And with those words, Jesus bowed his head and died.
Truly this was the Son of God.
This is
After Jesus' death, the apostles went into hiding for fear of their own lives. On the third day, Mary Magdalene came to the room, excited and jubilant.
He's alive! I've seen him! Jesus is alive!
That's not possible!
Mary told her story, and the apostles listened, dumbfounded in silence. They looked at each other with uncertainty, each waiting for the other to speak first. At last, Thomas spoke.
I can't believe it. I don't believe it.
When the others remained silent, Thomas, becoming annoyed, turned and asked them,
"Do you believe her story? Can you possibly believe her?"
After several long moments, it was Peter who spoke.
"I think I do. After all, it is what he prophesied. He rose us from the dead. Why then should he triumph from death himself?"
of us all. Struck down in our stead, rejected and scorned, and by his wounds we are
The apostles were silent as they puzzled over this staggering thought. A moment later, they could hardly believe their eyes. Jesus stood silhouetted against the light in the doorway. Some of them shrank back, more frightened than before. But Peter cried out,
"Master!
Why did you doubt me? Why were you afraid? I am here."
His presence dispelled the dark shadows from their faces.
They were caught up in a great wave of warmth and joy, as when old friends meet after a long absence.
After a few moments, Jesus spoke seriously, yet with undiminished affection for his friends.
"Why were your hearts troubled? Why were you so slow to understand? Remember the words of the prophets. The Son of Man will suffer and die, and he will rise from the dead on the third day. And in his name, repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached to all nations. Receive the Holy Spirit. Go now like lambs among wolves."
"Lord, stay with us, and the night is falling."
"Do not fear. I will be with you until the end of time." I told you to start that the way of my cross is incomplete until I crowned it with my death. And your way will only be complete when you have crowned it by your life. In order to do that, take up each cross that presents itself to you, whether small or large. Have the faith that I'll be there to help you carry it. Seek me at your school desk, workbench, office, or kitchen, for these are altars where I am present. Go now, take up your cross, and live your lives fully, fearlessly, faithfully, and lovingly, knowing that I am with you always.